Jerusalem, Ilayalami.
Tautama, vala a watu ile nei taiau, ile amatainga, te sauninga ilo whānau, whāo u mailona amatainga, se io o ilona whai iu. Whāmanuia ile ie mātou le whānau, ile suafa Jesu. Amen.
Today I'll be reading from the book of John chapter 15 verse 1 to 17. I hope you all will be blessed by the word of God this morning. I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me, and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not remain in me, he is like a branch that is thrown away into the withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you remain in me, and my words remain in you, Ask whatever you wish, and it will be given you. This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. As the Father loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love, if you obey my commands. You will remain in my love, just as I have obeyed my Father's commands, and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that he laid down his life for his friends. You are my friends. If you do what I command, I no longer call you servant, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I have learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit that will last. Then my Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. This is my command: love each other. Amen.
Today I will be singing a song to glorify the Lord.
Let us not love in word, tongue, but in deed and in truth. God bless.
Awesome.
I'm
so
mad.
Perform for you today. So happy White Sunday. We're going to sing a song. First, Eliza's going to do a makua, right, Bob? Ephesians 6, verse 1. Yeah. Ephesians 6, verse 1.
Children,
obey your
parents.
Do it again. Children, obey your
parents.
Alright, we've got a song now. We're going to do B-I-B-L-E and then we're going to sing Head, Shoulders, Knees and Toes. Alright, ready? One, two, three, go. It's a B-I-B-L-E. Head, shoulders, knees and toes. Ready? Alright, action. Ready, go.
Head, shoulders, knees and toes, knees and toes. Head, shoulders, knees and toes, knees and toes. Eyes and ears and mouth and nose. Head, shoulders, knees and toes.
Got it? Alright, say thank you. Happy White Sunday, everybody. Happy from Eliza Pritchard, who is my grand niece, and me. We were both representing Elama Maido family. Bye.
Bye.
Good.
This is a lot of my.
ma mai le fai tau wina le nei tai au le awhiunga pa ia le atua. Ma o mai le tusi fatu oto, ma tau upu tolu, fai upu mua mua se yo lima. Lo watili ie, awa nei ngalo ya te oe lau tū lafunu, a ia tau sia au polo a ino lau loto, a wā e whaapopo ina ai a te oe, o aso e tele, ma tau sanga, e te ola ai a toa, ma le manuia. Awa nei tea ma oe le alofa, ma le faa mauni, ia aso ai lo ua, ia e tusi ai i le papa o lo loto. Ona e maua ai lea o le alofa, ma le manuia, le lei i luma o le atua, a toa matangata. Ia e faa tua tua ia e ova, ma lo loto a toa, e a wā le faa lango, lango lango i lo lava atamai. I le suafi Yesu, amini.
Beside each other, come with me, 'cause I promise you. Scrap it up.
John chapter 15, verse 1 to 17. And the reading is from the book of New Living Translation. I am the true grapevine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch of mine that doesn't produce fruit, and he prunes the branches that do bear fruit so they will produce even more. You have already been pruned and purified by the message I have given you. Verse 4, remain in me and I will remain in you. For a branch cannot produce fruit if it is severed from the vine, and you cannot be fruitful unless you remain in me. Number 5, yes, I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who remain in me and I in them will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Anyone who does not remain in me is thrown away like a useless branch and withers. Such branches are gathered into a pile to be burned. Number 7, but if you remain in me and my words remain in you, you may ask for anything you want and it will be granted. Number 8, when you produce much fruit, you are my true disciples. This brings great glory to my Father. Verse 9, I have loved you even as the Father has loved me. Remain in my love. Number 10, when you obey my commandments, you remain in my love, just as I obey my Father's commandments and remain in his love. Number 11, I have told you these things so that you will be filled with my joy. Yes, your joy will overflow. This is my commandment. Love each other in the same way I have loved you. There is no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends. Number 14, you are my friends if you do what I command. And number 15, I no longer call you slaves, because a master doesn't confide in his slaves. Now you are my friends, since I have told you everything the Father told me. 16, you didn't choose me, I chose you. I appointed you to go and produce lasting fruit, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask for using my name. This is my command, And number 17, love each other.
An actor plays the part of Jesus, and though no actor is worthy of such a role, it has been done so that we may understand and benefit from the life of Jesus.
I am the real vine, and my Father is the gardener. He breaks off every branch in me that does not bear fruit, and he prunes every branch that does bear fruit, so that it will be clean and bear more fruit. You have been made clean already by the teaching I have given you. Remain united to me, and I will remain united to you. A branch cannot bear fruit by itself. It can do so only if it remains in the vine. In the same way, you cannot bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine. And you are the branches. Those who remain in me and I in them will bear much fruit, for you can do nothing without me. Those who do not remain in me are thrown out like a branch and dry up. Such branches are gathered up and thrown into the fire, for they are burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, then you will ask for anything you wish, and you shall have it. My Father's glory is shown by your bearing much fruit. And in this way you become my disciples. I love you, just as the Father loves me. Remain in my love. If you obey my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have obeyed my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My commandment is this: love one another, just as I love you. The greatest love you can have for your friends is to give your life for them. And you are my friends, if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because servants do not know what their master is doing. Instead, I call you friends, because I have told you everything I heard from my Father. You did not choose me. I chose you, and appointed you to go and bear much fruit. The kind of fruit that endures. And so, the Father will give you whatever you ask of him in my name. This, then, is what I command you. Love one another.
Early in the morning, talking it over, me and God.
Okay, starting from verse 1 in chapter 15 of the book of John, Jesus states, I am the true vine and my Father is the husbandman. That means, in some dictionary, it means a person that cultivates the land. A person that cultivates the land. A farmer, a gardener. The book of John, you may be familiar with Jesus' teaching styles. In the book of John, it's mentioned 7 times, Jesus has said this, I am. Using this physical terminology to describe and teach a spiritual reality, he has said, and that he's taught us, I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the door of the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And then chapter 15, Jesus said, I am the true vine. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, this is verse 2, every branch that does not bear fruit, he takes away. Every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it may bear more fruits. How does the Lord treat the first branch that does not bear fruit? He takes it away. The function of the gardener is to work with the garden to assure that the health and growth and fruitness, that is what Jesus is doing in our lives, isn't he? How does he do that? He cuts off every branch that neither bears no fruits. That's the thing that happens to branches that is really not connected to him. So they never drawn their life from the vine. They're just hanging on. Have you ever seen anyone work in the vineyards or the orchard? If there's a dead branch, get rid of it. It's not connected. It's not alive. It's just like the Judas. He spent the better part of his years hanging out with Jesus for 3 years. He was there, but he was never alive. Those branches just get cut. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. Every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, that it bears more fruits. Pruning means you take a scissors and you cut things off, removing things. Pruning is what part of the plants that's just infested with bugs all over the plant, the place, and you don't want it to spread. So if I could relate verse 2 to Hebrews chapter 12, verse 4 to 11, God disciplines his children. And your struggle against sin, you have not resisted to the point of shedding your blood, and you have completely forgotten this word of encouragement that addresses you as a father addresses his son. It says, "My son, do not make light of the Lord's discipline, and do not lose heart with when he rebukes you, because the Lord's disciplines the one he loves, and he chastens everyone he accepts as his son." Number 7, it says, endures hardship as discipline. God is treating you as his children. For what children are not disciplined by their father? And if you are not disciplined and everyone undergoes discipline, then you are not legitimate. Not true sons and daughters at all. Number 9, it states, moreover, we have all had human fathers who disciplined us and we respected them for it. How much more should we submit to the Father of spirits and live? Verse 10, they disciplined us for a little while as they thought best. But God disciplines us for our good in order that we may share in his holiness. No discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who have been trained by it. So that's the scripture that I found in Hebrew chapter 12, verse 4 to 11. Now, moving on to verse 3 of John chapter 15. Verse 3, you have already been pruned and purified by the message I have given you. Jesus reinforces his disciples, you're clean, you've been pruned, you're in me, you're all good. Verse 4, remain in me and I will remain in you. For a branch cannot produce fruit if it is severed from the vine. And you cannot be fruitful unless you remain in me. That's from New International Version. If you find in other Bible versions, you'll find abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit itself except it abide in the vine, no more can ye except ye abide in me. All you have to do is bear fruit. All you have to do to bear fruit is to stay connected to the vine. That's all you got to do. Verse 5. I am the vine and you are the branches. Get your life from me, then I will live in you. And you will give much fruit. You can do nothing without me. A nice lesson. So, this word remain in me will repeat itself in the few verses ahead. There are two things. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. That is the promise. He said, just stay connected to him. How do I stay connected? Just stay in the word. Stay in prayer. Stay in fellowship with my brothers and sisters in Christ. Reading, open your heart. And what will happen if you don't, if you back away, you stop reading, withdraw, not praying like I used to, that fruit in your life will shrivel up. Do you see at the end of verse 5 where he says, apart from me and you can do nothing? That means, that might seem kind of harsh. It's a harsh statement to me. Well, you kind of think, oh wait, aren't there people in the world that are doing things all the time? Does that mean I can't do anything, or I can't get my degree, or I can't get married, or I can't have children, or I can't do good deeds apart from Christ? No, that's not what Jesus is saying. Remember, he is using a picture here, a vineyard, the garden. He is talking people about fruitfulness of the kingdom, not fruitfulness of the world. The fruitfulness of the world, like getting a job, making money, having children, whatever. Those are the things that the world live for. That's not the fruits that's going to last. There is no lasting value on those. All the money you make, your children will grow. We will all die. You and me will be all gone. Everything in the world will one day pass away. When Jesus is talking about if you don't stay connected, then you can't do anything, he is talking about eternal spiritual fruits, what you will do for God. It is in a positive if you do things in me. So for those of you who had the opportunity or the great privilege to pray with someone to receive Jesus as your Savior, that is a marvelous thing. That is eternal. That person you prayed with has been born again, and they will live with God is forever. What you did with that person is a forever thing. That is the fruit that is going to last. This is the kind of given to us alongside with the fruit of the world. Jesus is not speaking about the fruit of the world. He said to you, just flat out, apart from me, you can do nothing. Talking about spiritual fruit of the kingdom of God. Okay, so what is the fruit? If you go back in Galatians 5, verse 22 to 23, it states, but the fruits of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness. 23, it states, gentleness and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Okay, we are not supposed to fake it. We are not supposed to add it to our lives. We are supposed to connect to God. That's back in chapter 15. Okay, so this is the fruit of the world. We're not supposed to, you know, add those to our life, and then we're supposed to stay connected to God so he can bring things to our life. How do you stay connected? If anyone does not get his life from me, he is cut off like a branch and dries up. Such branches are gathered and thrown into the fire and they are burned. That's the verse 6. The reason why the branch is thrown away is because it's dead and they never had the life in them. It's just picked up. If the branch is shriveled up, it will be burned. They will eventually all rot. The branch will rot the leaves because it no longer receiving the life-giving nourishment. In Jesus' case, Jesus' picture, the vine, he said, remain in me. Verse 7 states, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will and it shall be done unto you. That's King James Version. So, ye abide in me and my words abide in you. Ye shall ask what ye will and it shall be done unto you. So, if you cling, stay close to me. Stay at home. What's going to happen to you? You'll bear fruits. You'll know how to pray. Things will be happening for you. Your prayers will be answered. Read the Bible all the time. And if you remain in me and my words in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be given to you. You'll be overwhelmed. Jesus is saying it will be given to you. Why? Because you are abiding. Verse 8, it states, "Herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit, so shall ye be my disciples." When we bear fruit for the Lord, it's for him. This is for his glory, fruits of the life. People saying you're neat, that's glorifying them. Remain in my love benefits the remaining in Christ. When you bear fruit and people saw it, they would say things like, "Wow, you're awesome. Wow, you're so good at this." That didn't glorify God, it glorified you. But real fruit brings glory to the Lord. And if you're struggling with loving God, or if you're struggling with the love of God, asking, "Does God really love me?" Verse 9 states, "When you produce much fruit, you are my true disciples. This brings great glory to my Father." And verse 10 says, "When you obey my commandments, you remain in my love, just as I obey my Father's commandments and remain in his love." This is one of the most beautiful benefits of remaining in Christ. This is an assurance of his love. When someone is saying they're not sure if God loves me, I believe that is a symptom of someone that is not abiding as they should. So the more you spend in the word and in the presence of God in your life, he will communicate his love. You have to think to God as the best parent. Some might have a hard time relating to that. Those who parenting you could imagine. God will keep reassuring you all the time, constantly doing that from abiding. Verse 10, if you find there are some issues of if God really loves me, you need to really meet his love at the cross. If you have met his love at the cross and you're a born again Christian, maybe the Holy Spirit is confronting you today. He's saying that we aren't really hanging out, and devil likes to sneak up and bringing that question up. So it gets louder and louder, voices in your head. Look at verse 11. "These things have I spoken unto you. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full." Read that verse. Wow, his joy, it's mind-blowing. Here is a man, Jesus, before his day is over, he will be on the cross suffering with the burden of the world on him. He will be whipped within 24 hours. Some people die from the whipping. He's going to go through all the things. He's talking about joy at this point. And if you know that is in your mind, whipping would be talking joy? Would you be talking about it? His joy has nothing to do with the whole heap of things, the sins that will be on his shoulders. His joy comes from knowing the Father and knowing God's will. Christians, when Jesus is asking about abiding in him, the joy that comes to you and I, that is founded upon knowing I am loved by God and fulfilling purpose for my life. I am abiding in the vine. Verse 12, "This is my commandment, that ye love another as I have loved you, standard as I have loved you." He said love each other. How does he love us? He laid down his life. Then he says in verse 13, he said, "Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends." There's no greater expression love than sacrificial love. Someone, Jesus, laid down his life for his friends. Is he asking everyone to lay down our lives for our friends? Yes, he is saying that. We need to sacrifice so they can continue to grow. God is speaking to your heart. Pruning gets hard. He is asking us to love. He said there is no greater love. Verse 14. Ye are my friends if ye do whatsoever I command you. This is in King James Version. And verse 15. Henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I have called you friends, for all things that I have heard of my Father I have made known unto you. Everything I learned from the Father I made known to you. That's what he said. What is the definition of a friend? Does it relate to how Jesus treats us? One that is fully formed. You and I fully formed. We got 66 books. The complete revelation of God. Not saying it's the essence of God, otherwise we'll be worshipping that book. Complete revelation of God. A friend knows it all. You and I can say we are friends by the grace of God. We are friends. Verse 16. Have you noticed? Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you, and ordained you that ye shall go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever ye shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it to you. King James Version. He's saying, you didn't choose me, I chose you. Fruit that would last for eternity. Father would give you whatever you ask in his name. Verse 17. Things I command you that ye love one another. He repeats that, yes. And we have some work to do on that one. You know what we have to be very careful. He's not telling us to love each other and amongst ourselves. The whole context he means, it's the idea of the fruit being connected to the vine, Jesus. If you look at the other person in the body of Christ and you said, I just can't love them. You know, there you are. That's just you. You know what? If you are abiding in the vine, we are receiving that life-giving nourishment from the vine. He is making all things possible, and your life including, to love one another as he loves us. Amen. So hopefully I was able to help you in that. So thank you for listening. Father, I close today and thank you for your holiness, and thank you for giving me the wisdom to be able to speak up about John chapter 15 verse 1 through to 17. Thank you, Lord Father, for opening our hearts and opening our eyes to make it known to us on what you are speaking through us, and making us understand all this about the vine, Lord. Lord, I ask you to bless each and everyone who's listening tonight, today, anytime around the world, Lord. Bless each and every soul in Jesus' name.
Tato we for Matalo. Le tu mato tama, fa te iloanganga pa ia, fa atasi mai I le fa uina lo polo kalame o lo whanau, fa te ila fa uinga I mato le whanau, I e tele mawalunga so vi inga, I e fa amanuia I o mato. Matua, I may say for you, Matua, le whanau. One Yesu, amen.